rejoice.
Say,
from the beautiful studio at our world headquarters, it's Rejoice in the Word with Bishop George Bloomer. Featuring Craig Mizell and the Rejoice in the Word band.
It's time to rejoice in the Word.
God bless you. I'm Bishop George Bloomer, host of Rejoice in the Word, which can be seen every Friday night right here on the Word Network. Today, tonight, I'm in Jacksonville, Florida, at Global United Fellowship, and I have something great for you tonight. We are experiencing in the world tragedies and conflicts, issues with marriage, issues with relationships, and it seems as if the newspapers are reading like the ancient texts. What are we to do? The Bible tells us or teaches us that the fervent, effectual prayer of a righteous man availeth much. We've all heard the scriptures that says, if my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray and seek my face, and I'll hear from heaven and I'll heal the land. If we, God's people, would turn from our wicked ways. And somehow or another, when there's a tragedy in the land, the Christians quote that scripture. If my people who are called by my name would humble themselves and pray, seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then I'll hear from heaven and heal the land. And what God is actually saying is that the land is in trouble because the people of God are not in place. That probably shouldn't be the scripture that we should quote when calamities come, because it's an indictment on us. It's actually saying that we don't pray, we don't seek his face, and we refuse to repent and turn from our wicked ways. Now, if that's the case, then that needs to be confronted. But I know something that is going to happen and something that's going to shake this land, and that is our return back to the basic fundamentals of prayer, spending time with God. I'm a spiritual warfare preacher, not one of those crazy deliverance preachers where you're coughing up things, but someone who understands that if we take a little bit of time, God will give us a strategy to defeat the enemy. A few months ago, I had a tremendous opportunity of going to a film that was about to come out. And I went to a screening. A few preachers, we all got together, and I sat there scratching my head because I was a little bit bothered because I had seen maybe 12 screenings already in this year. And so I went there as a friend of a friend, and I was gonna watch this movie, and as it started playing, it dawned on me, this is it. This is it. For the first time, Christians had come together with a plan, a strategic plan on how to teach us how to locate the enemy and how to send our angels to combat those demonic forces. It's a movie entitled The War Room.
Hey, I'm Alex Kidder.
And I'm Stephen Kendrick.
And we're on set in Concord, North Carolina, working on our newest feature film.
We're making a movie.
This film is about the power of prayer and the necessity of prayer in our lives.
It's what opens up the floodgates for God to come down and be involved in our everyday circumstances.
Most of us have something of a financial strategy, an education strategy for our children, maybe even a health strategy.
To win any battle, you've got to have the right strategy and the right resources.
But oftentimes, when it comes to prayer, it's a wish to the wind.
A lot of people don't pray because they don't believe it works. But unfortunately, it doesn't work because we don't really pray.
God calls us to a much deeper level of faith.
He has us fight, not human flesh and blood, but fight the war that is in the heavenlies. That can only happen from our knees.
So if I was to ask what your prayer life was like, would you say it was hot or cold?
I don't know that I would say it's hot. I mean, we're like most people. We have busy lives. We work. But I would consider myself a spiritual person. This movie is about a husband and a wife who have a marriage that's hanging on by a thread.
There's one thing we do well, it's fight.
Elizabeth is a wife and a mom who really is struggling when you meet her in the movie. You don't know it from looking at her. She kind of puts on this little polished professional veneer, but underneath there's lots of huge cracks. The main one is her marriage really is falling apart.
My character, Tony Jordan, is a very successful guy. I think Tony represents a lot of guys in America. He works his job through himself, the status that it has, what it can give him, and how he appears to people.
Tony, how's my favorite rep?
I'm real good. How you doing?
Tony Jordan could care less if God blesses him. Tony Jordan hurts if he doesn't get the sale.
We want to say thank you and let you know there's a nice bonus coming your way.
I like that. You see Tony Jordan running into different people that continuously just feed the flame.
Look, Tony, you can fight against your wife and maybe hold your own. But if God is fighting for, you can hit the gym all you want, bro. It's not looking good for you.
Can I ask you how much you pray for your husband?
Well, very little.
And an older, wiser woman who comes into this young wife's life and shows her how powerful a weapon prayer can be in helping to keep her family intact.
Now, I used to do what you and your husband are doing, but it got me nowhere.
I don't have time to pray that much every day.
But you apparently have time to fight losing battles with your husband.
If you look at the history of the church, the history of revival and the Great Awakenings, it always was connected to people unifying and praying for the Lord to work in that situation. And that's what we want to happen in our generation.
If we return to prayer, passionately, actively seeking the Lord, and we're right with Him and right with each other, God can do amazing things in our lives.
We're asking God to use these productions as a unifying agent in the body of Christ. When the church becomes one, as Jesus prayed that we would be, not only will His blessing fall, but I believe it's a catalyst of revival in our generation.
You need to do your fighting in prayer. And you need to kick the real enemy out of your home with the Word of God. It's time for you to fight, Elizabeth. It's time for you to fight for your home. It's time for you to fight the real enemy. It's time for you to take off the gloves and do it.
Tonight, for the entire show, I have the cast of this phenomenal movie that I know is going to be your greatest evangelistical tool as we're getting ready to fight the forces that are coming against the church. I want you to call a neighbor and call a friend. This is a must-see tonight. I'm here with the entire cast, or portions of the cast, of this phenomenal movie. And so that I don't do what I normally do on Friday nights, mess up people's names, I'm gonna have them to introduce themselves, and then we are going to have a little bit of a chat about the war that is actually going on. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing fantastic. So I'm Alex Kendrick, the co-writer and director of War Room with my brother Stephen, and it's an honor to be here.
Hi, Stephen. Stephen's not here.
So my brother produced it, and then I directed it. And
so you didn't produce it?
No, Stephen produced it.
So you didn't produce it?
I did not produce it.
Okay, all right.
I need to honor my brother.
There you go.
And my brother got all the ingredients. He brings it to the table so I can cook, if I can use that analogy.
Yes.
But, yeah, I'll tell you what, I'm excited about what God's doing with this. Well, He's doing more than I ever asked or imagined.
Well, you cooked up something amazing, and we're going to show the world that the Christians are no longer going to be over in the corner
allowing these
crazy demonic movies to rule the summer. Summers and the winters and what have you, we're going to be in the marketplace.
Hey there, my name is Priscilla Shire, and I get to play Elizabeth Jordan in War Room. It has been a gift to be a part of this film.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
And my name is T.C. Stallings, and I play Tony Jordan in War Room. And again, like they said, I was just proud to be a part of this movement. It's going to be good.
Hi, I'm Karen Abercrombie. I play Miss Clara.
And No. You're not Miss Clara. All right, Miss Clara. See, Miss Clara, that's how you get the devil. He thinks he knows something, and then you show up another way.
Yes.
When we cut to the movie and they see you in the movie, they can say, there is no way in the world.
That's right.
That's her. But that's her.
Yes.
All right. I want you to prepare yourself. 855-730-WORD is the number that is at the bottom of the screen. Tonight, I want you to call in, and I want you to call your prayer request in. The prayer counselors and warriors are there, and they are in place ready to take your request before the Lord. We are going to have a night of absolute, total breakthrough. Our nation has been under a satanic attack. And it is coming from the political arena, and the enemy strategically is fighting against our liberties. And while the world is doing what the world does, we understand that the church is asleep. And so I pray that this movie and movies like this would wake up the body of Christ so we can occupy as God intended for us to do. You don't really, really have to fight demons and evil forces if you would just fight the good fight of faith. And the good fight of faith is a fight of spiritual enforcement. The victory is already won. The Lord has already won the battle. We just need to be in place and enforce those areas that he's given to us. And so we're going to be doing a little bit of talking, and I want to first start off by getting a little bit into the background of the movie and how did the movie come about? How was it birthed? And then we'll let the baby grow up as we begin to talk.
Yeah, there you go. A few years ago, my brother and I wrote and produced a movie called Courageous that was calling men to be the spiritual leaders of their homes. Before that, we had done a movie called Fireproof and then Facing the Giants before that. And we learned between each film to commit a season of prayer. And you know, there's a difference between a good idea and a God idea, and we needed God ideas. Mm-hmm. And so, and I would say that, you know, the Lord's the best storyteller of all of us, you know, better than Steven Spielberg or anybody else. He knows how to tell the best story. And Jesus told parables, as we know, to impart truth to people. And so making a movie is a way to do a visual parable. And so we were praying, God, give us the direction you want us to go. And he pointed us to prayer, the power of prayer, the necessity of prayer, and to call his church back to focused warfare. This is not a time to do comfortable prayers or convenient prayers.
So let's talk for a few minutes about prayer and bring some definition to prayer.
Yep.
Because a actor or a rapper gets a Grammy or MTV award, and he holds it up and he thanks God for this, and this is what he's been praying for. And so the word prayer has been somewhat neutralized.
Diluted, yeah.
And diluted. So when you hear the word prayer, what comes to your mind?
Well, biblical prayer, as we know, is first acknowledging who God is and acknowledging who we are.
Yes.
You know, and I'm not on that plane. You know, we acknowledge God for who he is and acknowledge what he can do, mm-hmm. acknowledge our own sin to get right with him and to seek him. He is a holy, powerful God. He is the creator of the universe. Mm-hmm. He has everything in his hands, and he affords us this wonderful gift of life that we're meant to honor him with.
Yes.
And so in this thing called sin that we all are a part of, we have to repent of that, acknowledge what it is, and seek him. So when I think of prayer, I think of this relationship with the holy God of who he is in charge of everything. But I acknowledge that. I seek him. My purpose is in him. Any power that I have comes from him, activated by faith and seeking the Lord. And so I commune with that God, the creator of the universe, and through his son, Jesus Christ.
So who can pray or who should pray?
Well, I can pray through Jesus Christ. I'm a believer in Jesus Christ, God's Son, who died on the cross, rose from the grave for my sin, paid the price for my sin, and shed his blood. And so I can commune with God through Jesus Christ. You know, John 14:6, when Jesus, yeah.
Hallelujah.
Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, the life.
No man comes to the
Father but by me. Jesus is not a way, he is the way.
Hallelujah.
And so I go to the Lord through Jesus Christ. And so, you know, people say we're all children of God. We are in the sense that God created mankind. Mm-hmm. But to have that spiritual relationship with the Lord must come through Jesus Christ.
Wow. And when you hear prayer, what comes to your mind?
Well, I think that prayer is the divinely authorized mechanism
that God has given his people to access
divinely
the victory. Everybody
mechanism.
Wants their own methods, but there is a way that he has authorized and mandated for his people to be able to open up the floodgates of heaven and, like you said, experience the victory that has already been won for us.
Wow.
So prayer is that opportunity that we have. And why would we have a key so grand as that and then just leave it and push it to the side and not use it to access and to allow the bounty of heaven to be a part of our regular experience? Wow. It's a shame that we do.
And you would hear prayer?
It's just one of the most graceful things that God could do. I mean, he could have just allowed us to have to live this life and figure this whole thing out for ourselves, but in his grace, he allows us to talk to him about his purpose for our life. And it's an opportunity for me to hear from God each day concerning my purpose, which is the most important thing to me. I'm a purpose guy. I know he made me for a reason. And being a sports guy, I like to think of it as going into the football game, without talking to the coach and thinking I'm going to score some touchdowns with nowhere to go when he holds all the plays and he's seen the game play out. And to me, it's just senseless to, that wouldn't work in sports. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't work, playing on God's team either. So I just, it's a gracious thing. And it's a commandment that I feel with anyone who calls himself a Christian should be obeying. And it's just, again, I just think graceful. I would hate to live this life without having a connection with God. And through Jesus, I have that.
So before I ask you about prayer, let's recapitulate. So prayer for you is somewhat of a sacrifice, that Christ is your sacrifice, and you go to God through him according to the scriptures and through him and only him. And a prayer for you is a special key. It's the authority, access, where you can access the throne of God, but not your way, but the way that God had laid it out for you. And yours is acknowledging him, asking him for moment by moment, day by day, bread by bread, give us this day our daily bread. Mm-hmm. That's powerful. And so when you hear prayer, prayer means what for you?
Prayer is a communication through a precious pipeline that Jesus died to make available to us so we can speak to our Creator, mm-hmm. our Source, mm-hmm. our Father God.
Mm-hmm. Wow. So the movie was birthed out of a need, and do you see what is happening in our nation? There's a 400-year-old document that we call the Constitution.
Yes.
And there is five or six people, lawyers, who sit in a room and they interpret what was in the mind of the forefathers of the nation without going further back to the memoirs of the forefathers, mm-hmm. In God We Trust. Mm-hmm. Men who made mistakes, but nonetheless, a lot of them were guided by God. And years later now we have immorality being legislated.
Oh, phew.
And you have the church only gets up in arms when things happen because we don't pray. And so because we don't pray, we don't have the key to access what's going to happen tomorrow, what's coming down the pipeline, so we're not ready for it. But nonetheless, having said that, because that's my own pet peeve, the point that I want to make is this immorality because a part of the movie deals with marriage, and we'll get into that. This same-sex agenda that is happening in the nation, all 50 states, and we're now celebrating this on covers of magazines. Gender selection is huge and big. Mm-hmm. Where if I were born and I don't like who I am, I now have the power to change myself, disregarding Romans 1:21, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. So now they take sin and they clean it up and they make it a civil rights issue.
Yes.
And churches have embraced this ideology also. And so with a movie coming out like this, War Room, this is really, really, I don't know if it was in the mind of your brother or you when you was putting this together that this movie would be coming up against this attack in the nation.
The Lord knew that. And you know, and what you're setting us up, I'm getting fired up a little bit here. What you're setting us up, I step back from the 30,000 foot view. What I see is we have displaced God. We have kicked God off the throne and said, your definitions and your ways and your guidelines do not matter to this culture anymore. And we've put man and his logic and definitions on the throne. Mm-hmm. And so when I hear everyone defending everything you're talking about, they're defending it as if man's view is the priority. That is not the priority. God is on the throne, and we must determine. And it's a form of idolatry to say, God, you're off the throne. Mm-hmm. What we say goes, because it makes all the sense in the world to us. Mm-hmm. This is who we want to be. Don't we have a right to be happy, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Well, if man is God, then yes, go right ahead. But man is not God. God is on the throne. And he is the ultimate judge, and he will judge every single one of us. And by the way, he judges us individually, Scripture says. We'll all individually stand before. He judges us as churches. You can read through, and he judges us as cities and nations.
Yes.
Did he not judge all of Israel and all of Edom and all of Egypt, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera?
And all of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Yes, he did. Cities. He
and
judges
all
cities.
Of Sodom and Gomorrah.
Yeah, oh, my goodness. So God is judge. And if he is God and if he is judge, we have a lot to answer to.
Because he's God and because he's judge,
yes,
we have a lot to answer to.
You got that right.
It's coming. And so you fired up about that, aren't you?
Yeah. He ain't messing around.
I did not know what would be going on in our culture a year and a half before War Room, because we were writing it, praying through it, but the Lord did. Mm. And that's why God's people must be spending time with the Lord, not conveniently, not comfortably, but doing warfare. You don't go to war to be comfortable. You don't seek convenience when you go to war. You go to war to win, and you say, why are we going to war? We're going to war because we stand on God's word and truth. We are defending truth, and we will be persecuted for it. But what does Scripture say? When persecution comes. And we are blessed. So if we help transform our nation through the word of God, we're blessed. But if we don't or persecuted, we are still blessed.
Beautiful.
Marriage. The movie centers around marriage. I'm going to call her the old lady in the movie.
Mm-hmm.
She reminds me of a woman by the name of Ganame Rango, who moved into Red Hook Projects. I was born in Brooklyn, New York.
Mm-hmm.
Red Hook Projects. She moved on the sixth floor, apartment 3E. And she put bumper stickers from the top of her door down to the bottom. Prepare to meet your God. Jesus is coming again. Don't touch this door. The Holy Ghost is here. And she moved into the project. She would wear white all the time and the earth shoes with the pleated dress. It was a whole Pentecostal woman.
Mm-hmm.
And across the hallway from her was my mother's house, three apartments. And going on in that house was fatherlessness, drugs, alcoholism, card games on the weekend, fish fries. But on Saturday, we were raised as Adventists. So on Saturday, we went to Sabbath church. If the Lord were to come on Saturday, our whole family would be ready to go back with the Lord. When the sun went down on Saturday,
right.
We had a card game that would last from Saturday to Monday morning.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
People brought their booze and everything. As a little kid, I learned how to do mixed drinks, mm-hmm. and what have you. And in that house, the Lord sent Miss Rango to Red Hook Projects to move in that projects to get me saved.
Amen.
I got saved. So when the movie was unfolding, and I don't want to expose the whole movie, when the movie was unfolding and how Miss Clara, that was her name, right? Mm-hmm. How Miss Clara was strategically moving around and using the gift of discernment, discerning mm-hmm. that this mm-hmm. the young lady who thought she had it all mm-hmm. really, really had nothing mm-hmm. and began to, you know, unfold it. I saw my life unfolding mm-hmm. because I knew what happened. I had a $300 a day crack cocaine habit that one woman with prayer broke that thing over my life. Because she refused to move away and kept on ministering in one area. And Miss Rango has gone home to be with the Lord now, but she said this. She said that she was walking one day and she saw a fire hydrant in the projects, and she saw the water dripping, mm-hmm. and it was just dripping. And she said 2 years later, she noticed that the water was still dripping from that fire hydrant, but the concrete had buckled.
Wow.
And so that's how she learned how to pray. That even though she wasn't seeing anything but consistency, drip, drip,
persistence,
drip, drip, mm-hmm. and finally the saturation of that water loosened everything that was holding it together
Thank you,
and
Lord.
Caused it to buckle. And the church is so now so into quick prayers and quick everything and quick services, and we got multiple services and get them out real, real quick, that the time that is needed to, for the consistency is not there. So when I saw Miss Clara in this movie moving around and what have you, and strategically planning and praying those drip, drip prayers, I thought to myself, that's Miss Rangel. And I told the preachers who was in the room, I said, I know that lady on the on in the movie. Then when I saw the movie again, and then I saw it again, and I saw it again, and every time I saw the movie, people was in the room saying, I know her. I know somebody like her. I have a Miss Clara.
Praise God.
I want to ask you two questions. One, where is the Miss Claras? And can you call them into existence in the church today?
I believe so. And there are still some Miss Claras out there, but like the church around many of them, people have been lulled into a slumber. And Jesus, God in church is not given time. He's put on a, okay, in 5 minutes we will, and she's up and okay, in 5 minutes. So when you, the worship happens and then the spirit comes and he's ready to heal and move and all of these things, and then he's on a time, okay, and we're gonna move along. So when you summon, you have to lay open and allow him to do what it is you've been calling him to do, praying for him to do, crying for him to do, pleading with him to do. You've got to give it to him. Mm-hmm. Give it up. Give him time. Mm-hmm. Let him do what he's going to do. Mm-hmm. Don't put him on a time schedule.
Wow.
The old preachers used to say, just tarry at the altar.
Tarry at the altar. Altar call.
The young people don't know nothing about that.
Don't know nothing about that.
They don't know nothing
they
about.
They compartmentalize it, though. This is worship time. This is my hour or two a week.
Yeah.
And then, but to chase after God, Jeremiah 29:13. If you seek me, you will find me. If you seek me with all your heart, not part of your heart, not.
If you seek me, chase after God,
and He can be found. He wants to be found.
And that's why Jesus said, "My house shall be called a house of prayer." Not a house of programs
or a house of good singing or a house of good preaching. That's right.
We have to get back to the purpose of the church, which was to pray.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Wow.
Yes.
That's good.
Yes.
I want you to stop what you're doing and think for a moment where you're losing it at and why you don't have the victory that you had just a few days ago, a few months ago. Could it be that you've invited a God in, but have not allowed him the time that he needs in order to saturate so that the strongholds in your life can buckle under the pressure of God's anointing? And then I want you to go to the phone, and I want you to call the number at the bottom of the screen, and I want you to say, I need Jesus, but I also need healing. I also need deliverance, because we want to pray for you. In a few moments, we're going to come back and have a little talk about marriage in America.
You've been a good enough father. I want to be a good enough father.
Let's go, let's go!
Don't quit! Don't quit!
You are good, and you are mighty, and you are merciful. Praise you, Jesus. Guide me to who you want me to help. Raise up more that will call upon your name. Raise up those that love you and seek you and trust you. Lord, we need an army of believers and will stand on your word above all else. Raise up warriors, Lord, who will fight on their knees, who will worship you with their whole hearts, Lord. Lord, call us to battle, that we may proclaim you King of Kings and Lord of Lords. I pray these things with all my heart. Raise them up, Lord, raise them up.
Hey, you know what? Thank you. There's not too many platforms that are willing to be this bold and talk about the issues as they are. So this is good.
Now that's one of the things that makes the Word Network a blessed place to be, is that the owner of the network, long as the numbers stay in place, he doesn't. Most of these Christian stations, they tell you when you go do an interview, they come in and they say to you, "Don't talk about this."
Yeah.
Don't talk about that.
That's right. Mm.
It
occurred to me, adulterers don't get together and parade down the street and say, "Approve of our adultery." Mm-mm. And thieves don't get together and parade down the street and say, "Approve of our theft." But homosexuals will.
And the question is why?
And they'll walk down the street and say, not just approve of us, but legislate it, force the nation.
Yeah, we were just talking, I just said the exact same thing. It's because the world has their own definition of what sin is. So that's a clear defined sin in the world's eyes. You know, you steal, you kill, but my sexual orientation or who I want to marry, that's a choice that we should have, not a sin. So the hardest part is for them to understand that it's sin, and they think that, you know, your Bible says it's sin. That's not.
Well, what some of them believe is that the sin is you forcing them to live a life of fornication. Mm. That was in one of the write-ups.
Mm-hmm.
So the reason why this Reformed church, this gay church, is they say, because if they said marriage is honorable in the sight of the Lord and the bed is undefiled. So what they wanted was to be honored with that. That is the most craziest. But you have churches and organizations, the United Methodists, when the ruling went down, the next day they said all of our priests, all of our ministers will be marrying same sex. So we know that the world is going to do what the world is going to do. The issue is that this is the setup for them to come against our religious freedoms.
That's right.
Watch this.
Oh, yeah, exactly. That's what it is.
This is the setup.
But you're also right. You alluded to something earlier, that part of the reason that we're in the situation we're in is because the church has not been the church. Mm-hmm. When we are not salt and light, when they trample on our saltiness because we're so lukewarm and lost our flavor, and we're not making.
Well, I'm amazed that you're saying that, because all right.
Because
you are my topics now. Are we going to have the second part going to be nice? I think you're going to be scared.
As much as I hate to say it, the church is a central reason why the culture is what it's doing.
And that's what that scripture was talking about. It says, "If my people."
Yes. Was, yeah.
And they keep on using that as like, you know, "Oh, we're going to come." Huh? Yeah, it doesn't mean Americans. It's the other world. No, he's talking about. Our problem is that we have. You ready? Because I don't want to spill my stuff on the floor. Let's use this.
All right now. George.
No. Ready in 5, 4, 3, 2.
I'm still here with the cast of War Room. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is reproach to any people. When you have what I refer to as utility preachers or pastors, men that just use the word reverend for their platform but say nothing about God, then our religious or spiritual foundation begins to crack.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what we have going on in the nation. For the past 6 years or so, the nation has been under a satanic cloud, and this cloud is the cloud of immorality. Preachers are preaching, preachers are literally leaving their pulpits, becoming life coaches. Churches are turning into cultural centers or empowerment villas. They don't want to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And so, small wonder why the Lord would drop this into your hearts to bring on a topic such as this. I promised you that when we come back, we would talk about marriage. My mom and my dad had 9 children together. My dad went out of the wedding barn and had 15 other children by 6 women in Red Hook Projects. And y'all know who y'all are. And we had all kinds of issues that came up due to that brokenness, and it released what I refer to as an iniquitous spirit or a generational curse. And so marriage didn't work in my family. The divorce hit me, it hit my sisters, my brothers, their families, on my mother's side, on my dad's side. It was a spirit, and it had a right to dwell. So when I began to watch the movie War Room and I saw that it was taking on this particular topic, it was the first time that I saw it on TV, much less the big screen, where we just looking the enemy in the face and we're saying, you can't have our family. So the question now is, what is marriage? Marriage for me is not just the coming together of two individuals, but it's the coming together of two families and the coming together or the cohesiveness of a community. So when a marriage is attacked, the entire family and two other families are attacked, their children's children's children to the third generation, and there's a crack in the community. And so it affects everything that goes on. When you have in a marriage community, you have several families who are married, and then you have a woman, a young lady who is in that community, and she's not married, and she's beautiful. It causes the entire community to shift a little bit. The wives have a problem with her being there. The husbands are looking when they're not supposed to. I know this sounds crazy, but it's really, really true. That God's idea for family is not a woman raising 6 children, although thanks be to God for those that are able to do it and do it well. But that's not God's plan. What God's plan is for it to be a powerful unit in that household. And the enemy consistently shows us that there's no need for the man. And he continues to do that. So as I saw the movie begin to unfold, it actually spoke to all of those issues. It spoke to all of those circumstances. And I just thought that was powerful. And someone is watching tonight and saying, Bishop Bloomer, I'm really, really going through in my marriage and I need help. That's why we are here tonight, to answer your questions and to give you an opportunity to get free. And I want you to speak to that.
You know, first of all, marriage, and you can look at it, marriage from so many different vantage points, but marriage is a picture. You know, we're the bride of Christ. If you are in Christ, a marriage is a picture of two people coming together in multiple ways to form one union. They are one. And Jesus prayed in John 17, Father, make them one as you and I are one, that the world would know you sent me. There is power in marriage. And when we have a relationship with Jesus Christ, we're the bride of Christ, and we spiritually come together as one. And God, as Father, provides for us. You know, Jesus, what does He not afford us, especially spiritually? And husbands are supposed to love their wives as Christ loved the church. So I don't deserve God's forgiveness in my life. How can I possibly judge my wife harshly and expect her to live up to my standards? So just as God loves me, I'm supposed to love my wife. As the Lord Jesus sacrificed everything for me, I'm supposed to do so for my wife. That's a hard thing for men to do, but it's also an exercise in humbleness for me. Now, what does the enemy want to do? He wants to divide that because it's something that is designed by God. God is the architect of this beautiful picture of marriage, that where you learn to love one another, and then there's offspring, there's life that comes from this relationship. There's no other pairing. You know, you don't have 2 salt shakers on a table. You have a salt and a pepper. You don't have 2 peppers on a table. There's no reason for a second pepper.
Right.
You have salt, pepper. They go together, and they're different, right?
Unless it's Dr. Pepper.
So what's the enemy want to do? He wants to divide this marriage. He wants to cut up this unit, this unity that God gives us a picture of. There's also a spiritual connotation there. And so He distracts us. This is in the movie. He distracts us from what we should be focused on. He deceives us. Hath God said? And then He redefines everything so that He can divide us. He wants to divide us from our spouse, divide us from the Lord, divide us from our children and each other. And that's how He takes steps to win. So marriage is a crucial element of who God is.
I want you to take a moment and I want you to watch this right here and see the reason why Miss Clara was called into the Union.
I appreciate you coming this morning. Coffee will be ready in a couple of minutes.
Oh, sounds good. Now, I ran a sales report from the area. Wrote down a suggested asking price for the house.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what do you think?
Mm-hmm. Now, what did you say your husband did for a living?
Well, we actually haven't talked about that, but he's a sales rep for Brightwell Pharmaceuticals.
Mm-hmm. And where did you say you attended church?
Well, we occasionally attend Riverdale Community.
Mm-hmm. So you would say you know the Lord?
Yes, I would say I know the Lord. You think the Lord is okay with this asking price?
Mm-hmm. And you have children?
Miss Clara, my husband Tony and I have been married for 16 years. We have one daughter, her name is Danielle, and she's 10. She enjoys pop music and ice cream and jumping rope.
Oh, well, that's good to know. Now, you say you attend church occasionally. Is that because your pastor only preaches occasionally?
Miss Clara, I really would like to help you sell your house. That's why I'm here. As far as my faith is concerned, I believe in God, just like most people. He's very important to me.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me get our coffee. So if I asked you what your prayer life was like, would you say that it was hot or cold?
I don't know that I would say it's hot. I mean, we're like most people. We have full schedules. We work. But I would consider myself a spiritual person. I'm not hot, but I'm not cold either. Just, you know, somewhere in the middle.
Here you go. I've got cream or sugar if you need it.
Oh, no, thank you. I like it black. Miss Clara, you like your coffee room temperature?
No, baby, mine's hot.
So, Miss Clara, the call that was on your life in the movie, how does that pair with your real life? How is Miss Clara different from you?
I was not the prayer warrior that, I'm not the prayer warrior that Miss Clara is. And though I had mentored some young girls, wow, not to the degree that Miss Clara has or is.
So you was acting?
Yeah.
Yeah. No, but
I mean, I pray.
I know.
I pray.
I'm,
but
I understand. The way Miss Clara comes across out of that screen, mm-hmm, is, that's real.
Yeah.
That didn't come from a well someplace.
God used these guys to write this piece.
Yes.
And then, well, there's a whole story how they found me, and I won't go into that right now. But when they got to me, I was prepared to do what needed to be done, you know, through God. So,
she, you know, it had to be a believer.
Yeah.
And Karen is.
Yeah. Yeah,
so it had to be a believer because you can tell. And it was funny, every day on set, we the start of the day off in prayer, I mean, with Bible studies and devotions, and then before each scene we would pray. I don't know how many times we would get together and pray before scenes. So the Lord was on the set. But we wanted a believer that had put their faith in Jesus Christ, mm-hmm, for the role of Miss Clara, and so we found her. So she's being very humble and saying, mm-hmm, this, I don't pray like Miss Clara does. Well, I mean, I've made movies where I look at myself on the screen and I say, Lord, help me step up to that. Help me step up to,
yes,
that. You mentioned courageous earlier.
And there are days where I don't live courageously, and so I'm convicted, and so I have to get right and take a step again. But this movie is a call to all of us, and I was convicted writing the film. I don't know if when you're working on a sermon or something, you're like, oh man, Lord, you're speaking to me as much
as
anybody.
Yes.
And so, but Karen was the right person, being a believer, and the Lord had prepared her to deliver this message through this film as Miss Clara. Mm. So are we all hitting home runs? No. I mean, sometimes, you know, we've given messages and preached on Sundays before, and our wives say, you know, you better apply this to your own life.
That's right.
You know, but Karen was the right person for that.
Or the wife turned around and said, I like to meet the person that was up
there.
Oh! I want to meet him.
Meet that guy.
But you were in sports, right? Mm-hmm. How was the character different from your own personal?
Tony Jordan was actually similar to me in a lot of ways. If you could just replace the pharmaceuticals and the drive to be the best person in the company, and you could care less about what God wants. You just care about, am I the big dog in this company? For me, you just swap that with football, and you got T.C. Stallings.
Wow.
Football ran everything for me. It was God for me. I just took Jesus along for the ride. Like, Jesus, I want to go to Louisville and get a scholarship. Come with me. I want to go to NFL. Come with me. You know, so I understood that relationship to be a good one, a proper one, but it should be more along the lines of Jesus, you know, pulling me along, and I'm going where he tells me to go. And if you want me to play football, I will, but that wasn't me. I lifted weights, I trained, I did everything I could do to be the best football player I can be, and that's what drove me. And if that wasn't going right, my whole day was messed up, and if it was going well, I felt on top of the world. And so that's the similarity between me and Tony Jordan.
How do you deal with all of the ladies that hate you now?
Well, see, it's a dual purpose. I went through this with Courageous. TJ's job in Courageous was to make you fear him, hate him. And if somebody didn't say that, I was offended. Like, no, you know, I want you to, you know. So with Tony, there's this incredible arc that he needs to take you on. I need to be able to get you there. And praise the Lord that happened, because now you can watch the Lord work in my life. And that's really the essence of being a Christian. You know, things that happen in your life that allow the Holy Spirit to show his power is where it's at.
Yes.
That's when people like, hey, I've been there, and I watch how you come out of that. I want a piece of that, Jesus, you got, because, of what I saw. So Tony will have you saying, you know, man, if he can do that through that guy, because I knew that guy, he can do it through me.
Right. No, I saw when you came in and you were walking down the aisle, and I was sitting next to someone, and the lady hit the other lady, and she said, "Look at that guy that was acting."
That's right. That's right.
So we live in a world of reality TV, and they sort of kind of think that, you know, this is Housewives of Atlanta.
People don't even say how you doing. They just say, "Hey, I hated you."
But we've seen him with his wife Lavette, and he's the most kind, gentle, loving husband to his sweet wife.
Yeah.
So yeah. So just if you like the guy at the end, then that's me.
What do you feel? That this movie should convey first to the body of Christ and then to the world?
Well, to the body of Christ, among many things, I think that and hope that it will really put a motivation in the heart of the older woman, the seasoned woman, to be intentional about mentoring.
Wow.
Not just kind of hope that along the way maybe she can pour into a young woman's life, but you find that Miss Clara is seeking this woman out. She wants to be able to use some of the hurt in her life, the growth that she's had in her life, to invest into another person and help that person to not make the same mistakes. And I think Titus 2 is a little bit lost in the church, where you've just got a generation of younger women who are just running around trying to do marriage and ministry and raise their kids all alone. But there's got to be a Miss Clara in the life of a younger woman. And, you know, let me just say that it was Elijah who went and found Elisha.
Wow.
Yes.
And Miss Clara has got to have her eyes open, peeled in her sanctuary for a young woman that needs her. And I hope it is a message to the younger women to be teachable. To welcome and invite and want the Miss Clara to guide and lead and direct and teach, instead of this arrogance that you sometimes find in the younger generation of women who just don't want to be taught. They just think they know what they're doing, and we don't.
And that comes from, that sort of attitude comes from, in many churches, the absence of a Miss Clara.
That's exactly right.
And when you hear the word mentor, what comes to your mind?
Somebody who is, obviously there is a wisdom in their life that they have carried for a certain amount of time, where you've been able to see the fruit of them walking with the Lord, but also there is an availability. Mm. They have the openness, the willingness, the time to invest into another person. And so there's a season of life when, you know, it's hard for me in this season of life, raising three small boys, to be able to invest in other women. I can do it, but to be able to do it in a way that someone in Miss Clara's season can, who is retired,
right,
maybe, or who's already raised her
kids,
that's the time when you have an opportunity to really single out some women and say, hey, y'all come over and gather with me once a month, once a quarter. Let's just sit down and talk about what's happening in your life. And you sit at my feet and you listen.
Wow. And they're coming from a wealth of experience when they're in that season of life. The younger women maybe can share an experience, but these seasoned women and men, for that matter, that are investing in the generation younger than them, they're pulling from that wealth of experience, whether they did something right or wrong. The younger generation can learn from it.
Yeah.
I'm a product of people investing in me.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So,
oh, yeah, me too.
Yeah.
And so Miss Clara in the movie has the time. Mm-hmm. And you know, she's got the time to wait till the coffee pot gets the coffee really hot. Because you're not doing this lukewarm stuff.
And what did she say in the film? She says, Lord, send me another one.
Send me another one.
You know, you send me someone, help them cross my path. Put them in where I can grab them and introduce myself and whatever.
And, and not only that, but then she looks Elizabeth squarely in her eyes and
tells
says,
her to do
you
the
need
same.
To go get you somebody.
That's right.
To do the same.
Now, like,
right.
We can't just be me and you for the rest of our lives.
Right.
We got to go multiply this so that other women know as
There's
well.
The gospel spreading.
Yep. There it
That's
is.
That's exactly right.
Okay. So now let's go into the room. Into Miss Clara's closet, and the clothes are now moved out, and you know, you go into this room and you sit down. You got these things on the wall, and you got the prayer going. Let's talk about that.
That's some powerful stuff. A room specifically dedicated to just that, and when you put things in front of you where it's visual. And it just keeps it at the forefront. You know, you nail at it, you cry about it, you pray about it, and you're just right there. And the room dedicated specifically for this. This is the war territory. This is the war room.
Yeah.
So
I get it, but you know, in every African-American, classical Pentecostal church, there was a sanctuary, but there was also a prayer room.
Yeah, right.
And even when the service was going on, if something wasn't right or correct, they would take you out and carry you to that prayer room, and they would work that thing until you got your breakthrough.
Right.
So the new churches have done away with that. So you know, you just go to the altar and don't stay there too long because we got to close the sanctuary. You know, that kind of stuff. Mm. And so we were having a discussion of that. Is it really, really necessary to have a prayer room, or a place that you call a war room? To which I responded, is it really, really necessary to have a bathroom in your house?
Right.
Bedroom in your house, a dining room in your house.
That's good.
A closet for your clothes. You have a room
for everything, but
you have no room for God.
Right.
Oh, that's a good analogy. That's so good. And what does Matthew 6:6 say? When you pray, go into your inner room, it says, and shut the door.
Yeah.
Because this is not for show. This is not to please men. This is not to show off. It's you and God. And you shut the door, and your Father who sees what's done in secret will reward you.
So
this is coming from the Lord. And what did Jesus do? Over and over and over. Yes, He was with the people. Yes, He ministered. But He left the people to go off by himself to pray and seek God. And not, I shouldn't say seek God, because Jesus is a little bit different, but to spend time with God.
Yes.
We have to do that. We have to do that. That's a discipline.
Yeah, and in that passage, it says that the disciples come looking for Him, and they're like, where have you been? What in the world are you doing? Don't you know the whole city is out here looking for you? And if that doesn't sound like our lives in modern times, especially, I don't know what is. You know, everything we got is buzzing.
That's right.
You know, we got everything vibrating and buzzing and ringing, and there is just, you know, the whole neighborhood is always looking for us. You know, we've always got our lives surrounding us, pressing in on that time. That time has to be reserved with the Lord, and that space has to be reserved with the Lord. And there's a quick little line in the movie, though, that I don't want people to miss because I think it's so great. I think it's your voiceover, Miss Clara, while I'm in the closet praying, but you say that there is no magic in the place that you pray.
Mm.
And I think that's so important because for some, you know, I want somebody to be encouraged now that's living in a small little space and you actually don't have another piece of square foot where you can devote specifically to prayer in terms of a room, but you have this little corner.
Absolutely.
You have a corner and you can just put those 3x5 card prayers, paste them to that little corner in your bedroom, and that little corner in your room is the place that you have made a sanctuary. If you can't clear out the closet like Miss Clara has, because you ain't got no other closet.
Right.
Well, you know what? You have a corner in your bedroom.
Absolutely.
Or in that bathroom.
In that bathroom.
Absolutely.
You can just put
and
your
that
prayers on the wall.
There. Place becomes a place of honor and that precious relationship, just you and the Father.
That's
just
right.
You and the Father. So no, it doesn't make a difference whether it's a corner or a big room or a closet, you know.
It's undistracted, where you're
undistracted,
not distracted,
absolutely.
Which is the joke when Elizabeth's character in the movie goes in them and she just, I'm not taking all my clothes out of this closet. You know, I'm just going to, it's more convenient for me to pray comfortable in here. And then she starts like, oh, I haven't worn these shoes in a while. She's all distracted, right?
Yeah.
So the point is, get alone with God where you're not distracted. And He is your focus.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. And it's so powerful. How many times in the book did people build an altar?
Mm-hmm.
Then that just becomes that place.
Hey, I'm Alex Kendrick.
And I'm Stephen Kendrick.
And we're on set in Concord, North Carolina, working on our newest feature film.
We're making a movie.
My favorite Kendrick Brothers movie, by far, I love Forrest Gump.
And action crowd.
Our first film was Flywheel, which was basically about lordship. Then we produced Facing the Giants, which was primarily about faith. Fireproof was primarily about unconditional love. Courageous is obviously about courageous parenting, specifically fatherhood. This film is about the power of prayer and the necessity of prayer in our lives.
It's what opens up the floodgates for God to come down and be involved in our everyday circumstances.
Most of us have something of a financial strategy, an education strategy for our children, maybe even a health strategy.
To win any battle, you've got to have the right strategy and the right resources.
But oftentimes, when it comes to prayer, it's a wish to the wind.
A lot of people don't pray because they don't believe it works. But unfortunately, it doesn't work because we don't really pray.
God calls us to a much deeper level of faith.
He has us fight not human flesh and blood, but fight the war that is in the heavenlies that can only happen from our knees.
In Matthew 6, Jesus said, when you pray, go into your inner room, in your secret place.
We seek God first before going to war, if you will.
That verse and that passage is one of the keys to this movie. It's really easy to make prayer an afterthought. We want people to begin to fight their battles in prayer first.
So if I was to ask what your prayer life was like, would you say it was hot or cold?
I don't know that I would say it's hot. I mean, we're like most people. We have busy lives. We work, but I would consider myself a spiritual person. This movie is about a husband and a wife who have a marriage that's hanging on by a thread.
There's one thing we do well, it's fight.
Elizabeth is a wife and a mom who really is struggling when you meet her in the movie. You don't know it from looking at her. She kind of puts on this little polished professional veneer, but underneath there's lots of huge cracks. The main one is her marriage really is falling apart.
My character, Tony Jordan, is a very successful guy. I think Tony represents a lot of guys in America. He works his job through himself, the status that it has, what it can give him, and how he appears to people.
Tony, how's my favorite rep?
I'm real good. How you doing? Tony Jordan could care less if God blesses him. Tony Jordan hurts if he doesn't get the sale.
We want to say thank you and let you know there's a nice bonus coming your way.
I like that. You see Tony Jordan running into different people that continuously just feed the flame.
Look, Tony, you can fight against your wife and maybe hold your own. But if God is fighting for her, you can hit the gym all you want, bro. It's not looking good for you.
They're just calloused. They've just got this hard exterior toward each other, and it seems like neither side is gonna break.
Look, I'm just tired of her. All right? I said it. I'm just tired of her nagging me. All right, I just don't need that. I don't need her junk, Mike.
Her junk? Dude, you married her junk and all.
They just are trying to get through life.
Can I ask you how much you pray for your husband?
Well, very little. And an older, wiser woman who comes into this young wife's life and shows her how powerful a weapon prayer can be in helping to keep her family intact.
Now, I used to do what you and your husband are doing, but it got me nowhere.
I don't have time to pray that much every day.
But you apparently have time to fight losing battles with your husband.
I don't know of anything that's more needed right now as a nation here in the United States than prayer.
If we can call the body of Christ to take seriously our conversations with God and we commit to pray, can you imagine what God can do in and through us? There is nothing impossible for our God.
You need to plead with God to do what only He can do. And then you need to get out of the way and let Him do it.
I don't even know where to start.
If you look at the history of the church, the history of revival and the Great Awakenings, it always was connected to people unifying and praying for the Lord to work in that situation. And that's what we want to happen in our generation.
If we return to prayer, passionately, actively seeking the Lord, and we're right with Him and right with each other, God can do amazing things in our lives.
We will see an explosion of the presence of God as a result of the prayers of His people.
We're asking God to use these productions as a unifying agent in the body of Christ. When the church becomes one, as Jesus prayed that we would be, not only will His blessing fall, but I believe it's a catalyst of revival in our generation.
You need to do your fighting in prayer. And you need to kick the real enemy out of your home with the Word of God. It's time for you to fight, Elizabeth. It's time for you to fight for your marriage. It's time for you to fight the real enemy. It's time for you to take off the gloves and do it.
For the past 2 years, I've been asking God to please help me find a tool outside of the four walls that I can use to help resurrect this dying discipline of prayer. God promised that if we call to Him, He will answer and show us great and mighty things that we do not know. A few months ago, along with three other people, I was invited to a private viewing of a movie called The War Room. Michelle Duffy, who serves as the Global Director of Marketing and Public Relationship for our fellowship, is someone who knows me well and knows of my mandate. And she just happens to be the marketing consultant and director in the African-American market for these movies. She invited me to come, along with the president of Sony, to view the movie. Ladies and gentlemen, I have never cried so much while watching a movie. During the movie, I heard the Lord saying to me, "See, I have answered your prayer." That night, I accepted that movie as a gift from God. And I concluded that it should be seen by every Christian believer around the world. I made a conscious decision that I will do all I can to get as many pastors to see this movie before it hits the theaters in late August. Because I knew then, and I know now, that once they see it, their prayer lives would be ignited and intensified. Ladies and gentlemen, it's happening because hundreds of pastors have now seen it, and hundreds of pastors have committed to buying out theaters on the opening weekend and inviting their congregations to view the movie.
There's a piece in the film, she's selling houses and what have you, and he is selling the
pharmaceuticals
and so on and so like that. And I want he's selling drugs. There's a I just want, oh, Michelle left. All right, I want to them to throw that. That would be the perfect place for the clip that they're gonna show of the movie running through, and it's when he's selling all these, he's stacking the numbers, and it's coming around to get him. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about demons. Do you believe that demons exist?
The scripture says they do.
Yeah.
And what are they then?
Well, they're, we can call them fallen angels, mm-hmm. but they are those that do the will of the evil one, mm-hmm. and that oppose us and stand against us, and they are against God's will for us, and so, the Lord is more powerful than they are, but if we are existing outside of walking with the Lord, then we're in trouble messing with them. Mm-hmm. And so we defeat them with the Word of God and with faith and the tools that God gives us to handle that. So yeah, they'll want to put a yoke around your neck and distract you and defeat you and get you depressed. And
I think the greatest weapon, so to speak, that they have perpetrated against the body of Christ is to make us think they don't exist, mm-hmm. or to downplay their significance mm-hmm. in the reality of our lives. So when our marriage is faltering, or our kid is going through something, or our finances are a disaster, or our health is caved in, yes, that could be attributed to other things. But I think that what the enemy has done is so disguised himself. In fact, 1 Corinthians 11:14 says that he disguises himself like an angel of light, that he wants to be so covered and clouded and veiled that we will attribute everything that is going on wrong in our lives to anything and everyone except the demonic influences.
That's right.
And if we want to stand firm against the enemy, we can't do that in our own strength. Ephesians 6 is clear. The Apostle Paul is trying to tell you, you've got to be girded in the armor, the weaponry that has been given to us, again, divinely mandated by our God. And don't you know that there are not just six pieces of armor, as everyone thinks? He closes out that passage talking about being girded with the armor. Mm-hmm. The last two verses in that passage there, Ephesians 6, 10 through 20, are on prayer.
Yes.
Everything else he spends maybe one little line or so mm-hmm. talking about this quick little piece of armor. But when it comes to prayer, two whole verses he devotes as if to say, none of this other stuff actually is infused or activated with the power that it needs to really stand against the enemy. Unless you're praying to make sure that it's activated and infused with the power of God so that the enemy is pushed back in Jesus' name.
And in Ephesians 6, we start off the whole engaging in spiritual warfare with verse number 10, when it says, finally, my brethren, be strong.
Yeah.
If it's saying finally, then that couldn't be the beginning of it. That would have to be the end. But Ephesians 1, 6 and 1 opens up and it says, obey your parents in the Lord, for this is right. Honor your mother and your father, which is the first
family.
So he starts off by telling you that those of you who have been born again, I have placed a mentor in your life, a spiritual leader who is going to give you spiritual principles on how to defeat the enemy, but you have to obey them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
You have to obey these spirit. Yep. And so in the movie, when she says, you go find you someone and you pour in, this is building your army, building mm-hmm. your group of individuals who you can call on to believe with you, travail with you for the breakthrough.
And see, because the thing is, you can have a Miss Clara, but if Elizabeth isn't going to do what Miss Clara is telling her to do, if she's not going to submit herself to the leadership of this mentor in her life, then their time really is wasted. Mm-hmm. So you not only have to have people that are willing to invest, but again, you have to have someone that is willing to submit themselves to the leadership of this mentor so that their life can be influenced and changed. They have to honor that authority and obey that authority in their life.
And the younger wife had Elizabeth rejected what her spiritual mentor is doing, is she not accountable for that to the Lord?
No.
And the Lord says, I'm affording this truth to you, to help you, to arm you. And when we reject that and stay in that lukewarm mindset, lukewarm spiritual life, man, are we not accountable to that, to the Lord?
Someone is watching tonight and they're saying, this is great. I love this Bishop Bloomer. It's different. It feels good. How do I pray?
Yep.
How do you pray? How do you pray?
You talk to the Lord. You have a conversation with him. There are not $10 words. There's not a seminary degree. There's not some theological references that you need to make. It doesn't have to sound good, which again is the beauty of this, this space where you're not trying to impress anybody. It is you authentically pouring out your heart to the Lord, letting him hear what he knows about you anyway, but being honest with him, laying it out before him, asking him for forgiveness of your sin, agreeing with him about the need for his grace poured out upon your life. And then, yes, bringing to him your needs. He says, make your requests known. So you come boldly to the throne of grace. You plant your needs there before him. And then I believe that prayer is not only speaking, but it is listening.
Yes.
It is waiting to hear what it is that his response is going to be to you. And yes, sometimes that response comes in the circumstances and the way he maneuvers things after you've left the prayer room. But oftentimes, if we would just linger there for a minute more, over that scripture verse. The word, the old preachers used to say, the Holy Ghost's job is to illumine the scriptures, to make that thing pop up off the page that you begin to find that that is the answer to what you've been praying for the last month and a half.
Preach, Rev.
That's good. That's good.
Yeah, but we don't take time to listen in prayer. If it's supposed to be a conversation with God, there's got to be.
It's a conversation.
It's a conversation.
The problem with conversations with God is our idea of a conversation is might not necessarily be what God's idea of a conversation. Say conversation.
Conversation.
Say it again.
Conversation.
One more time.
Conversation.
One last time.
Conversation.
Let's say it slow. Convert sessions.
Convert sessions.
That's right. When I'm talking to God, I'm telling him what I think.
Right.
When God starts talking to me, his whole plan is to convert my session, to change everything about me that I thought was okay, but if it was so good, I would have no need to go to him. As I'm speaking to God, God is saying, yeah, I understand that, I'm patient, and so. But if my son, if you do this, this, and this, this is what's gonna happen. And it's in those final moments of prayer. I say that like that because I was a crack addict. And after I got delivered from crack, you know, you were selling pharmaceuticals and stuff like that. I was too. I was a street pharmacist.
That's right. But anyway, that's right.
when I got delivered from crack cocaine, I started having dreams. And in my dreams, I was smoking crack. So the devil who couldn't attack me in the natural while I was awake
tried to get you
went into my spirit world, my sleep world. And I began to wrestle and fight with smoking crack. It had gotten to a place two or three times a month I would sleep for 12 hours.
Wow.
Go to bed when it's dark, wake up when it's dark. And I'm in crack houses, driving around in crack houses and what have you. And finally one day I decided to go and share it with the prayer group. I feel the anointing of God. I share it with the prayer group and talk to them about it because this was just literally horrible. And that was the greatest thing I could have done. So now while I'm in the crack house, I met up with a young girl whose name is Sylvia in the crack house. And for 3 months we'd had conversations in this crack house. I would even drive and pick her up and drop off to crack houses. And she was trying to get me to go back to shooting up heroin in the dream. And I remember the night where my sleeve was rolled up and I was ready to do it. She had pulled out this Hello Kitty bag. It was dirty, it was filthy, and inside of it was the spoon and the heroin and the matches and the syringe. And she had lit it up and everything was in place. And I'm sitting in this crack room with my arm rolled up and she's tapping for the vein to shoot me up with it. And I hear the saints calling my name. And I woke up. When I woke up, I had rolled the sleeve up to my pajamas and I'm up in the bed like this.
Oh.
That's the attack that I was under.
That thing is real.
That demonic spirit went into my dream life. And I got up and I shared it with the church. We went on a 3-day fast. A week later, I'm in California preaching, and while I'm up preaching, man of God, the reason why this film is so important, a war room, people praying for you, strategically, calling out your name in a secret place. I'm up preaching, and I look across this vast auditorium, and there's the girl that I saw in my dreams. So the Holy Spirit prompted me to call her name, and I said, Sylvia. She jumped up, and she started screaming. And I said, come here. And she came that way. And I said, the Lord said, bring the Hello Kitty bag. She goes back to her chair, brings the dirty bag that I saw in my dreams.
Wow.
Zips it open, and everything that's in the bag falls out on the altar. I lean down to get ready to say to her, I've been praying for you because I saw you in my dreams. And she's screaming and hollering. She looks up and she says, thank you, God, Bishop Bloomer. I saw you in my dreams. That what the Lord could not do, or what was not happening while our eyes was open up, the Spirit of the Holy Spirit was working in the spirit world with the angel that was assigned to her and the angel that was assigned to me, fighting those demons that were assigned to us. And we won. We won. It's that drip, 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 drip,
persistence.
Drip, drip,
yeah.
That persistence. Yeah. And those of you who are strung out, going through marital issues, you need healing in your body, whatever your situation is, don't give up on God. Find you a place.
Pray.
Just like you said, even if it's a little corner.
Yeah.
And have someone that you're connected to that you can tell your true story to, that can pray for you and intercede for you, intercede and intercession so that you can have breakthrough. And I promise tonight is going to be an awesome night of victory and breakthrough for you. 855-730-WORD, 855-730-WORD. That's the number at the bottom of the screen. We're waiting for you to call tonight because you're about to have a war room experience.
You got another bonus?
Yes, sir.
Dude, I went in the wrong line of work.
Well, I couldn't have been a paramedic.
You got that right, bro.
And you too. Call me to be a salesman.
Yeah, but could you imagine if I got bonuses every time I save somebody's life? Woo-hoo-hoo. Let's check it out. Heimlich, $200, right? CPR, $400.
Right?
Like 1,000 if they're ugly. Dude, you remember that one lady who had swallowed that garlic and she choked and had to give her mouth to mouth?
Yeah.
That should have been a Hawaiian vacation.
I couldn't have done it.
Yeah, you could do it. You're not just gonna let somebody die in front of you while you eat your salad.
I don't do CPR, Mike. I'd have just called 911.
That's just cold. You just gonna let somebody die? Yo, what if it was your wife? Hold on, bro. What? What's that? What is that?
What's what?
Dude, what's up with you and Liz?
Nothing.
Nothing? Look at you getting all tight. You got extra veins popping out that wasn't even there before.
Mike, I'm just tired of her, okay? All right, I said it. I'm just tired of her junk.
Her junk? Dude, you married her junk and all. It's not like some sort of buffet where you get to pick and choose what you want. You get all of her, bro. You better not have somebody on the side.
So you're trying to do CPR on my personal life now?
Okay, yeah, I'm a paramedic, but I'm also a Christian, which means I help people while I'm helping people.
My look, we've been friends for a long time, but some things are just none of your business.
True, and since we've been friends a long time, I'm not just gonna watch your marriage die. So if it's bleeding, I'm not gonna keep eating my salad.
See you in church.
I'd like to see the church in you, bro. Hey, somebody need to come move this.
God's real.
Yeah, but you said you asked her about prayer. I want to say something about that. Is another thing. You have to realize it's a process. And the way he answers, like when you were saying, the way we think a conversation is, it's not what other people think of a conversation. Whereas I speak to you, I get an immediate answer. Mm-hmm. And with the Lord, it's going to be a process. Mm-hmm. For example, with me, I remember when the whole war room thing started for me, I was running a gym, a personal training gym in Louisville, Kentucky, and everything was going great. And I said, Lord, I just want to honor you with this gym. You know, you've blessed me. This is a dream to have a gym. What do you want me to do with it? At that moment, He started to answer me, but I'm waiting for him to tell me, like, so should I do these classes or should I? He's like, no, you're gonna go 2,000 miles away to California.
Wow.
What I want you to do with the gym is shut it down. Mm. And so when you're having a conversation with God and you're praying to God, He will answer. His answer is gonna look like what He wants you to do. And it's the very first thing He'll do to you is what Romans 12:2 says, you gotta renew your mind. Because if I'm still thinking the way that I think, then I won't be able to process His answer. I renew my mind. He says, then you will know God's will for your life. So like, okay, God. So he starts to work on the mind. I haven't seen anything with the gym yet. It's like, because I'm working on your mind. And once my mind is right, it's like, okay, now I need you to get up and get out of here and go to the West Coast. Mm-hmm. And then you go to the West Coast, and then now you're lost. He's like, okay, because I want you to activate on faith. You got to just follow me. Follow the Holy Spirit. He'll tell you what to do. And it leads me to where I am. So, and I say that because a lot of people give up on prayer because they have their vision of how it should work. I'm going to pray to you something specific, and I'm going to get a specific answer. So my answer would have been God showing me something to do to train these folks, whereas God's answer was, okay, I'm going to start you on your God-given purpose for your life, and here it goes. It's going to take you totally in another direction. So if you understand that, you know, you'll have more patience, and you have faith, and you'll be able to wait and see what He wants you to do. So His plan to get somebody, like you say, off the crack or in another situation may require, first it's going to be a mind change, and then it may be a totally different direction into what they were thinking. So, I mean, that's just something I want to throw out there. But yeah, yeah. It's a process, and it's God's process.
That was a good throw, and mm-hmm. I believe a lot of people have caught that mm-hmm. because, you know, God is in the business of changing lives.
Mm.
And if you go into God with your ideas and want Him to bless your ideas so that you can remain the way that you are, that's not a good deal.
Mm.
While you're having a conversation with Him, He's having a convert session with you.
Yeah, he can't change your life until you change your mind.
That's it.
I think that's one of the undercurrent messages in this movie as well, is that, you know, Elizabeth is really wanting him to change. She's wanting her husband to get together. He's the one that needs to get together.
Yes.
And, you know, I know a lot of wives, I have been that way in my life as well, where we think our spiritual gift is to change our husband in Jesus' name.
Hey,
you
know?
So we hit our knees praying for our husband. And most of the time when you're praying for something or someone, God's answer comes in the form of what you need to do to adapt your life and align it more fully with himself.
Yes.
So you find Elizabeth changing as a result of her prayers.
Mm-hmm.
It becomes about her and the kind of way she needs to be responsive to her husband, and she needs to be supportive and respectful to him. She's the one who changes in the process of praying, and a lot of times that's the outcome of prayer.
Wow.
is what it does in you.
That's a great point, because she goes, they start talking about how to change me, and without giving the movie away, there's a situation that something that she does to her that makes her realize that she's the one that needs to do the changing. And then when she starts to work on her, Tony doesn't even change, basically, because, you know, God directly, you know, worked on me. I mean, there are some things that God does with me, but it is through what I see happening with her that gets my attention. And sometimes, you know, you want your children to change, then let God change you.
Mm.
And while you're praying for your children, I mean, He'll work on them, but certainly, you know, the person who wants to be the changer has to be changed first.
Yeah.
And I let the Holy Spirit, that's the evidence. I get excited about what I see. I saw that in you, now I want what you have. And
yeah.
So, you know, I end up, you know, not to give it away, but I want a bit of what she has.
Yes.
And you see that develop in the film.
So, there you have it. The cast, the producer or director?
Director.
Stephen Kendrick was an awesome producer. And these guys and their brother Shannon, who also works alongside of them, they make such an incredible team.
Yes,
incredible team on so many levels. But I will tell you that one of the most important and impactful level is that they have no interest, and this is the reason why I did the film in the end, Alex, is because they have no interest in making a name for themselves or pursuing fame or fortune, or they're not trying to get Hollywood necessarily to notice them so they can move on to bigger and better things. What they want in all integrity is for the Lord Jesus Christ to be lifted up. They want to draw all people to Him.
To the world,
yeah, that's it.
A clear message of who
Jesus
is.
And they're using their talents to do it.
And using the talents to do it. And that's what we need in the body of Christ. I thank the Word Network for this tremendous opportunity. I know you're going to have a lot more projects coming out. But I believe that this is the beginning of prayer being rekindled in our churches. Mm. I pray that it is.
May it be so.
And I pray that theaters would jam out. I have a team of people who go in with me, and we, in several movies, the one that Heaven is for Real,
yeah,
and that we were a part of, I was asked to put our team together to get maybe 50 theaters. We went and we prayed. We did 156 theaters. Mm-hmm. And I'm working along with this phenomenal woman of God, Michelle Duffy, and her company, and I'm believing that the Lord is going to do greater things like this. I envision and I see the movie ending, the credits going up, and people still in their seats,
yeah, yeah,
weeping, and someone, yeah, is looking for a preacher to give an altar,
yes,
call,
yes,
because change has taken place.
Mm.
And I believe that if we speak that into the atmosphere,
yes,
that is exactly what is going to happen. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
For being a part of this and for giving this to the body of Christ. Didn't get a chance to talk a whole lot about the movie because we want you to go see it. So you get there and do what you're supposed to do, and the Lord is really, really going to bless. Once again,
bless you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Well, like, I remember writing, or even humorous scenes, I remember writing certain things that we did, and it caught me off guard, the audience reaction. When she puts lunch plates down and he swaps the lunch plates,
oh, yeah.
I thought, well, the audience thinks, okay, so he's nervous about her.
That is something that's very identifiable within the African American,
yeah,
community.
That's right.
Well, see, the audience explodes, and I remember the first time I saw that, I was like, what in the world?
That's what's going on. That's right.
I didn't expect that to be funny.
You're either going to get a pot of hot
grits.
Or you're going to get
plates with it.
What does that mean, pot of hot grits? What does that mean? I don't know what that means.
So it's basically like, as an African American woman, if you have, or a man, if you have an issue and your wife or girlfriend is mad at you, you might get a pot of hot grits.
If you hit her.
Meaning some hot grits, right, like
off the stove, they put grits on.
Oh, man.
But the grits became popular in 1974 when Al Green got the pots going. That's where that came from.
Oh.
Al Green, 1974.
That happened to him?
It happened, yes, to him. And that became the thing. Oh, literally happened to him. Yes.
That was brilliant. That scene to me always gets a great laugh.
Yeah.
Well, see, I was just trying to communicate. She's released it to the Lord, right? So she's, hey, you know what? I'm going to let God sicken God on you, and I'm not going to worry about it. And he's all nervous and scared now that he knows that she knows everything. And so when the audience is responding to that, I remember looking at my brother going, well, why did that work?